On that first hot summer's day of the offensive on the Somme, 100,000 British troops went into action. They were mostly the proud members of Kitchener's army, a new army of eager and patriotic men who had volunteered in their hundreds of thousands to fight for king and country. By nightfall, nearly 60,000 of their number had been killed or wounded in 12 hours of fighting and slaughter unparalleled in British military history. It was the wholesale destruction of these courageous, innocent soldiers which has given the Battle of the Somme its special poignancy. How could so many lives have been lost in an offensive which gained practically nothing? In 1916, fond memories of plucky little Belgium, the underdog whom Britain had pledged to defend in 1914, were wearing thin. The combined British and French armies fighting against the Germans had managed to halt the initial German advance which had characterized that first year of the Great War. Those early days of the old contemptibles now seemed an age away. 1915 had seen the Allies take the offensive again with an almost total lack of success. Ground to a halt by the machine guns and trenches of a new and terrifying age of warfare. The turn of the year saw the Germans once more attempt to seize the initiative. The German High Command decided to launch a massive assault on the French fortress of Verdun. And on February the 21st, 1916, the first shells rained down on the fortress and city. This barrage heralded the start of a massive German offensive designed to overrun the French defenders, who with Gallic tenacity pledged to defend Verdun to the last drop of blood. There followed over 4 months of savage and bloody fighting, during which the French losses totaled over 315,000 men. The battle also claimed 280,000 German lives and won Verdun its chilling nickname, the Mincer. French spirits so unquenchable at the beginning of the battle were all but crushed. The French army was brought to breaking point. Even the public, who had so enthusiastically embraced the war, became horrified as the casualty figures mounted. But as the battle rolled on, the casualties steadily increased. The Germans deployed yet more men, and the French renewed their pledge to defend Verdun to the last man. The French ultimately committed 78 divisions to the battle, but their ranks were inexorably reduced. Soon the situation became desperate, and the French insisted on British help. Their chief of staff, General Joffre, demanded that the planned British summer offensive be brought forward to relieve the pressure. Otherwise, the French army would be obliterated and the war would be lost. High-level discussion brought forward the British attack. It would start on the 1st of July. The place? The Somme. It is often argued that the Battle of the Somme saved Verdun. But this is not strictly the case. For the inescapable fact is that by mid-June, the attack on the city was faltering. German alarm at their horrendous casualty figures, coupled with an understandable concern for their lack of success, were the two chief reasons for this. Another was the spectacular Russian victory, scored by Commander Brusilov on the Eastern Front, which broke the Austro-Hungarian lines and caused German troops to be diverted from the west to the east, again easing the situation at Verdun. So it fell to the British to provide the bulk of the troops for the major summer offensive that everyone hoped would mean a turning point in the fortunes of the Allies. The old British regular army, the famous Old Contemptibles of the BEF, had been destroyed by 2 years of inconclusive fighting in the earlier battles. The men who marched to the Western Front were almost exclusively new volunteers. Kitchener's Army, named after the Minister for War, Lord Kitchener, whose vigorous recruitment campaign had attracted almost 500,000 ordinary men to the colours. These men of the new army were eager, bursting, full of patriotism, ready to do their duty for king and country. But they were also raw and inexperienced. For many, the war offered undreamed-of possibilities of travel and excitement and prospect of glory. The menfolk of entire towns and villages had joined up, making up the famous PALS or Chums battalions, where the whole population of an area would serve together in the same unit. These were the men who would suffer so terribly during their first taste of battle. Before the battle, the war was still viewed as a magnificent interlude from the toil and hardship of everyday life. A war to be heroically fought and, of course, gloriously won. But whatever their background or rank, none could have prepared themselves for the nightmare of violence and slaughter that awaited them.
It's not always realised that the British sent four different types of armies to fight in Flanders between 1914 and 1918. The first, of course, was the old BEF, British Expeditionary Force, probably the most professional army we've ever sent abroad. They, of course, were mostly dead by the early months of 1915, something like 70% casualties by that time. So the next army which came out to France was the Territorial Force, as they then called the Territorial Army, which were all, again, peacetime soldiers who had done weekend soldiering and so forth, just as the TA does now. And they were very good in their turn, but by the end of 1915, I'm afraid they too had gone in large number. And so when we turn at last to Kitchener's army, we've come to the third and probably the most dramatic of all the armies we sent to France and Flanders that particular war. Now, of course, they were volunteers. These were mostly people who had volunteered in 1914, wishing to get into the war before it was all over by Christmas, was the famous phrase at the time. They'd been having 2.5 years being trained and were at the peak of physical fitness, but of course had no experience of the reality of battle whatsoever, except that which you could get at exercises or battle schools or the notorious Bull Ring up by Calais, where they were given their battle inoculation training. In their turn, the volunteer armies would have something like 600,000 casualties before the end of the year. So yet again, we had to produce the fourth type of army, and this was the conscript army. For the very first time in British history, we began to compulsorily conscript manpower for the armed forces. And that began in the autumn of 1916, and they will be the people who fought through 1917 and above all in 1918.
The opening day of the Battle of the Somme was fought on the middle day of the middle year of World War I. By this time, a position of stalemate had been reached by the opposing sides. For along the whole front line from the North Sea to the Swiss frontier, little or no progress was being made as the men of all armies dug themselves deep into trenches to defend their positions. To understand the nature of trench warfare is to appreciate the full range of horrors endured by the soldiers of the Great War. The typical British trench, seen here in side view, was usually 7 or 8 feet deep and 6 to 7 feet wide. Thick walls of sandbags provided protection from shell fragments or bullets, and in the walls of the trench were dugouts, where a man would sleep or shelter from the elements. British High Command actually discouraged the construction of comfortable living quarters, and these dugouts were often cramped and wet, and hardly conducive to affording the rest the soldiers so desperately needed. The British frontline trench was never built in a straight line. This diagram illustrates the system of fire bays and traverses, which were designed to protect the men against bursting shells and enfilading or machine gun fire. Running out towards the opposing lines was a sap, a precarious vantage point for nervous sentries to oversee or overhear activities in the enemy positions, or the approach of an enemy raiding party. To the rear of the main firing line were the support and reserve trenches, which completed the frontline system. The area between the two armies, called No Man's Land, varied in size from half a mile to only a few yards, depending on the lie of the ground. The positions of both were defended by thick belts of barbed wire. A major problem for the frontline troops was the sheer tedium of trench life, the dullness and difficulty of which was enough to wear down the hardiest of souls. Days were spent in an attempt to rest, while nights involved patrols, or digging latrines, or repairing trenches, or carrying up rations and other supplies. For most, this uncomfortable, wearying routine was broken only sporadically by action. What cannot be overstated is the appalling natural hardships which blighted the troops, whose living conditions were quite often intolerable. There was, for example, an almost constant battle, particularly in low-lying areas, against water and mud. It was only the arrival of summer which brought the troops some relief. Otherwise, each rainfall meant the same misery. Trenches ankle deep, often higher in mud. A soldier on the Somme remembers.
The mud makes the trenches all but impassable. And now, sunk in it up to my knees, and the momentary horror of never being able to pull myself out. Such horror gives me frenzied energy, and I have to tear my legs free and go on. Both sides are glued where they stand.
Some men actually drowned in the mud, and tales of men slipping into shell holes, gradually sinking, watched by horrified and helpless comrades, are well documented. These terrible conditions also heralded the appearance of trench foot, a condition similar to frostbite, which was caused by constant immersion in water. During the war, over 74,000 British troops were treated in France for trench foot. Sustaining the huge army on the Western Front presented even more problems. Whilst actively at the front, the men rarely, if ever, received a hot meal, their staple diet being bread, bully beef and biscuits. Drinking water too was in short supply. In the worst recorded cases, men were desperate enough to boil water drawn from the bottom of a shell hole. The filth of the trenches inevitably produced a host of diseases, and the men's unwashed condition brought the problem of lice, which tormented most soldiers. But if these horrors were not enough, without doubt the most unpleasant problem encountered by the British soldier was the rat, which grew to incredible size, bloated by gorging on the many half-buried corpses which littered the area around the trenches. Men would be woken by rats scurrying over their faces as they searched for food in their dugouts. A French soldier told one horrifying story. One evening, whilst on patrol, Jacques saw some rats running from under the dead men's greatcoats. Enormous rats, fat with human flesh. His heart pounding, he edged towards one of the bodies. Its helmet had rolled off. The man displayed a grimacing face, stripped of flesh, the skull bare, the eyes devoured. The rats coexisted with the men in the trenches. All efforts to rid themselves of their unwanted neighbours ended in failure, and the rats swarmed around in their millions throughout the war. All of these things contributed to the miserable life of the British Tommy on the Western Front during the war. Not only was he in danger from rifle or machine gun fire or shelling from the enemy artillery or the bullets from snipers, but he had to live with the daily risk of disease, infection and illness. British statistics tell the awful tale. During the Great War, there were more than 2.5 million casualties in battle, whilst 3.5 million were victims of sickness or disease. As his chief weapon, the British infantryman carried the .303 Lee Enfield rifle, fairly accurate up to 1,000 yards, with its long bayonet for hand-to-hand combat. The infantry were also supported by heavy machine guns, which took 6 men to operate and carry its ammunition supply. But it was a murderous weapon when in full flow, firing some 600 rounds per minute. In this most static of wars, however, the combatants were, for the majority of time, hidden from each other's view. So hand-to-hand combat was rare, and it was the artillery which was dominant. The frontline soldier never knew when or where the next shell would fall. He lived in dread of instant death or terrible injury. The noise and terror of an artillery bombardment can only be imagined. The threatening prospect of sudden bombardments at any time, day or night, and the effect of the shells when they did burst, led to many cases of shell shock, a physical and mental trauma caused by exposure to constant shelling. Unfortunately, many commanders, particularly generals, believed shell shock to be little more than an excuse for cowardice. Some frontline doctors agreed. However, Philip Gibbs, a soldier who fought on the Somme, described the condition after the war.
He was shaking in every limb, in a palsied way. His steel hat was at the back of his head. His mouth slobbered, and 2 comrades could not hold him. These badly shell-shocked boys clawed at their mouths ceaselessly. It was a common, dreadful action. Others sat in the field hospitals in a state of coma, dazed as though deaf and actually dumb.
Over half the British soldiers who served on the Western Front received some form of battle wound, which placed immense pressure on the hard-pressed medical services. Wounded men often received no medical help at all, and some lay in no man's land for 2 or 3 days before they were picked up by stretcher bearers. Needless to say, many died agonizing deaths. With only 4 stretcher bearers per company, the task often overwhelmed the men, for the physical effort of carrying a badly wounded man through the clinging mud left orderlies completely exhausted. Despite the terrible nature of many wounds, ordinary soldiers actually believed the hospital to be their best hope of escape from the trenches. So desperate were they to be free of their horrors, they would pray for a wound which would see them invalided out of the army and back to England. The much sought after Blighty one. Sadly, many wounds were severe ones. One observer on the Somme wrote,
"It's a good thing not to be too squeamish. The smell of septic limbs and heads is enough to bowl you over, and as usual, a good many deaths. But it's the multiple wounds that appear worse, men almost in pieces, and the number just makes the horror worse."
It was against this background that the plans for an offensive were being made in 1916. The year had begun optimistically for the British, with 2 new men in key roles. In London, the new Chief of Imperial Staff was General Sir William Robertson, and in France, General Sir Douglas Haig had taken over as Commander-in-Chief of the British Expeditionary Force. Without doubt, Haig was to become the central and most controversial character in high command during the war. He was a dour Scotsman, with a wealth of experience behind him, a man of strong opinion and great determination, who had earned the respect of colleagues and subordinates. His appointment as Commander-in-Chief was generally welcomed in the ranks. However, the circumstances which led to Haig's appointment caused unease and controversy. After the Battle of Loos, for example, he had been openly critical of Sir John French, then the British Commander-in-Chief. Haig had married one of the Queen's ladies-in-waiting, and thus had the ear of the King, who invited him to give his opinion on the battle. Haig repeated his criticisms.
"The King seemed delighted that Sir John French had been appointed to the chief command of the British Expeditionary Force. He asked me my opinion. I told him at once, as I felt it my duty to do, that from my experience with Sir John in the South African War, he was certain to do his utmost loyally to carry out any orders which the government might give him. I had grave doubts, however, whether either his temper was sufficiently even or his military knowledge sufficiently thorough to enable him to discharge properly the very difficult duties which devolved upon him during the coming operation with the Allies on the continent. In my own heart, I know that French is quite unfit for this great command at a time of crisis in our nation's history.
The outburst brought charges of disloyalty and careerism against Haig, although these were steadfastly denied by him. In his own mind, he was simply convinced that he was the man for the job, that French's recall to England was the right thing for both the army and the country. God was firmly on his side.
Haig was a complex character, we have to say that. At one level, he was a born intriguer. After all, he'd used his wife's connections with the royal family. She was a lady-in-waiting to the Queen, I think it was, in order to actually ditch his predecessor, General French. He was prepared to do that. He was also a very inarticulate man. The famous phrase goes, he was the only person ever been known to be totally inarticulate in two languages, because he prided himself about his French. But he was a very shy man, and found it very difficult to express himself, particularly when talking to troops or even to officers. Haig, of course, believed that the Battle of the Somme was going to be the war-winning battle. He was always the eternal optimist, of course. It might be called his greatest strength. Some would regard it as one of his weaknesses. Rawlinson, on the other hand, had much more limited ideas about what was going to be achieved. He hoped to get a break in, and perhaps even a limited breakthrough, but he had no idea of finishing the war with this great devastating blow. Now, Haig and Rawlinson were old friends. In fact, Rawlinson was in many ways a protege of Haig. He'd been keeping an eye on him for several years from before the First World War. But of course, Rawlinson was an infantryman, Haig was a cavalryman. And that was quite important in this case. We often hear about Haig overbearing critics and so forth, but in this one case, he listened to Rawlinson as a cavalryman with great deal of respect. And in many ways, it was Rawlinson's concept of the battle which was put into operation from the 1st of July 1916.
Haig felt strongly that the big Allied push should have been made on the Western Front in early 1916. But his plans were thrown into some disarray by the news of the massive German attack at Verdun in February of that year. Haig's original plan had been to attack with the French, to break through beyond the trenches into the open country and bring the war to an end that very year. But with so many Frenchmen involved at Verdun, the plan had to be revised and its objectives redefined. They were now threefold. Firstly, to relieve the French at Verdun. Secondly, to inflict losses upon the Germans. And finally, to place the British Army in positions favourable for the final victory in 1917. The place chosen for the assault was a 16-mile section of the front in the uplands of Picardy near the River Somme, a site considered more suitable than the swampy, marshy lands to the north. The area had been fought over many times before, by Henry V in the Hundred Years' War, by Louis XI and Charles the Bold, and perhaps most famously by Napoleon in 1814. The sector had been relatively quiet, with French and Germans operating a live-and-let-live policy until the British took over. But the increase in British activity persuaded them to strengthen their defences. This was the worst possible outcome of the increased British intelligence gathering raids and shelling. By June 1916, the Germans were very well dug in. In later years, none other than Sir Winston Churchill noted, "The French and British commanders had selected for their offensive what was undoubtedly the strongest and most perfectly defended position in the world." The German positions, always on the higher ground, offered uninterrupted views of the surrounding countryside. Crucially, they were often sighted in positions overlooking the British trenches. It was later observed after the battle that the most experienced army would have had difficulty taking the trenches. Most of Kitchener's army had yet to fire a shot in anger. Haig entrusted the main thrust of the attack to the new 4th Army, under General Sir Henry Rawlinson. Rawlinson had seen action in Burma and had fought the Boer War and was an experienced infantryman. He was to be a central figure in the coming battle. The 4th Army was ordered to take the German positions from Serre to Montauban, its most southerly point, and the River Ancre. The ever-optimistic Haig even ordered the bringing up of 3 new cavalry divisions, commanded by Lieutenant General Sir Hubert Gough, who were to exploit any gaps in the German lines achieved by Rawlinson's 4th Army, and push on into open ground behind the enemy lines. Haig sensed that this may be the cavalry's last opportunity to play a major role in battle, and he did not intend to see the chance wasted. To ensure the 4th Army had the best chance of success, Haig ordered a simultaneous diversionary attack from the 3rd Army to the north. To these men fell the task of assaulting Gommecourt, a well-defended German-held salient. The attack thus had the dual role of taking the salient and creating a diversion for the major attack to the south. The commander of the 3rd Army was General Sir Edmund Allenby. He and Sir Douglas Haig cared little for each other, and Allenby was unimpressed by the battle plan. Crucially, there was to be a 1 mile gap between the 4th Army to the south and the 3rd Army's diversionary attack, which Allenby knew would leave his men exposed to German fire on 3 sides. He therefore felt it could not succeed as a diversion, and furthermore would have little chance of gaining its objectives. Allenby's doubts were considered, but not accepted. Rawlinson had been much impressed with the opening of the German attack at Verdun, where he had seen their artillery smash the French front lines, preparing the way for the infantry, and he therefore determined on a similar strategy on the Somme. He decided on a massive bombardment of the enemy position, using every available piece of artillery, lasting 5 days and nights. Rawlinson would wait until the trenches were totally destroyed, then send in his infantry to mop up. The prolonged artillery bombardment was also intended to completely destroy the long, thick belts of barbed wire which defended the enemy trenches. The infantry would then be followed by the cavalry, who would move through to begin the pursuit of the shaken enemy. There were certain tactical disagreements between Haig and Rawlinson, and in particular, Rawlinson's plans for the 4th Army. Haig favoured a shorter barrage and felt strongly that the German line should be rushed in the traditional manner immediately the artillery ceased firing. Rawlinson disagreed, arguing that a charge by an overexcited, inexperienced army would be chaotic and that the lengthy artillery barrage would kill most of the frontline German troops anyway. Eventually, Haig, the cavalryman, deferred to Rawlinson's greater infantry experience, and it was his plan that was finally adopted. A 5-day artillery barrage, followed by a measured advance to occupy the devastated German positions. The plan agreed, the British prepared for July the 1st, and behind the front lines, whole divisions rehearsed for their part in the attack. Sappers dug tunnels under key points in the German trenches to lay several massive mines, which were to be detonated shortly before the main attack began. In addition, food and ammunition were moved to the front line in enormous quantities. General Headquarters had the unpleasant task of preparing for the expected number of casualties. But upon seeing their detailed plans, Rawlinson thought their provision inadequate.
With reference to the evacuation of the wounded from the 4th Army area, I consider it essential that means of evacuation by trains should be provided for at least 10,000 wounded per day, in order to avoid undue overcrowding and discomfort for the wounded in the casualty clearing stations and other medical units. In order to evacuate this number, 12 ambulance trains and 6 improvised ambulance trains will be required daily by the Army. it appears to be necessary that the number of trains available for the Fourth Army should be considerably increased. If the delays, which I understand, occurred during the Loos fighting in September last, are to be avoided.
The plans and preparations were believed to have been the most meticulous ever made for an action by a British force. Surely, as Rawlinson envisaged, all the men had to do was wait for the massive guns to do their work, then move across no man's land and into the smashed enemy trenches, which would be full of dead Germans or dazed survivors waiting to be taken prisoner. Their officers were confident. "You'll be able to go over the top with a walking stick. You'll not need rifles. When you get to Tiepval, you'll find all the Germans dead. Not even a rat will have survived." The Brigadier General of the King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry was even more confident. "When you go over the top, you can slope arms, light up your pipes and cigarettes, and march all the way to Pozières before meeting any live Germans."
Haig, of course, was hoping for a breakthrough, a major breakthrough which would lead to the end of the war. So it was a 17-mile front from north to south, and that is not even including the French sector south of the River Somme, which we must remember there were two or three French corps involved in this battle, who in fact did rather well on their sector. The disaster was going to be earned pretty much on the British sector. A great deal of importance was laid upon the preliminary artillery bombardment. General Rawlinson clearly believed in the old adage that artillery conquers, infantry occupies. And so they had this five-day bombardment, which of course sacrificed any concept of surprise in preparation, on the promise that that would destroy many of the enemy's positions, above all the barbed wire, which in fact it didn't, that it would cause a tremendous amount of shell shock and battle shock amongst the enemy, which of course it didn't, because they were mostly in 40-foot deep dugouts. And of course the British were also going to fire these famous mines along the German front to really destroy parts of the sectors, which they didn't, because the Germans rushed out with their machine guns into the huge craters and found themselves with new made positions courtesy of the British Army. But then the orders were given to these battalions of fresh, very keen, extremely kind of devoted troops, motivated troops, that they were not under any circumstances to rush forward. They were to advance at the walk. And that was going to be a disastrous detail in the events of the first hour of the Battle of the Somme, as we may see later on.
On June the 24th, the unimaginable thunder of the British bombardment began, raining shells upon the Germans without respite. Day after day, night after night, their trenches were pounded in an attempt to flatten the positions and kill those that cowered in them. Not surprisingly, the strain on the Germans soon became intolerable. A German infantryman remembered the barrage.
"Es ist Nacht. Werde ich den Morgen erleben? Wir denn nicht genug dieses furchtbaren Grauens? 5 Tage und 5 Nächte hat dieses Höllenkonzert schon gedauert. Man hat einen Kopf wie ein Früchter. Die Zunge klebt am Gaumen. Fast nicht zu essen oder zu trinken. Kein Schlaf. Jeder Kontakt zur Außenwelt unterbrochen. Jeder ein Lebenszeichen von zu Hause. Noch können wir eine Nachricht an unsere Lieben schicken." "Wie müssen sie um uns fürchten? Wie lange wird dies noch dauern?"
Initially, the ferocity of the bombardment gave real encouragement to the British troops about to go over the top. It was only towards the end of June, when the destruction should have been all but complete, the patrols sent out at night reported the ominous sighting of belts of barbed wire still fully intact. Their reports were arrogantly dismissed by High Command, who believed them to be the natural misgivings of nervous men about to go into battle for the first time. For their parts, Haig and Rawlinson remained confident. Haig entered into his diary on the eve of the battle.
"With God's help, I feel hopeful. The men are in splendid spirits. Several have said that they have never before been so instructed and informed of the nature of the operation before them. The wire has never been so well cut, nor the artillery preparation so thorough.
Rawlinson's message to his troops, if not particularly rousing, was typically down to earth.
In wishing all ranks good luck, the army commander wishes to impress on all infantry units the supreme importance of helping one another and holding on tight to every yard of ground gained. The accurate and sustained fire of the artillery during the bombardment should greatly assist the task of the infantry.
During the early morning of Saturday, July the 1st, the men waited in the front line. From Gommecourt to Montauban, the soldiers of the new army were about to see the battle they had sought when they joined up. Who can imagine their emotions as they waited, the guns still crashing over their heads? There they were, the pals, the chums, the volunteers, men of all ages and backgrounds, at last about to do their sworn duty. Early on that fateful morning, the ground shook as the seven huge mines were detonated under the German trenches, spewing earth into the air. At 7:30 exactly, the guns fell silent. The British troops stood in full pack, bayonets fixed, awaiting the signal to attack. Then, along the entire front, whistles blew and men climbed over their parapets, formed into waves as ordered, and walked slowly towards the enemy lines. It was now a race against time. The German machine gunners scrambled from their dugouts, dugouts so deep they had been untouched by the British barrage, and set up their weapons. In the deadly race against time, it was they who were the victors. Their reward was the unmissable target of thousands of British troops walking slowly towards them. The guns opened fire, and the carnage started. The British attackers were cut down by a frenzied, murderous hail of bullets, leaving no man's land strewn with dead and wounded. Within minutes, entire battalions had been all but destroyed, some having advanced only a few yards. This grainy shot with the dim figures struggling across the skyline is the actual footage of that infamous attack. Primitive camera equipment and the huge distance at which it was filmed make it difficult to discern, but against the hillside, if you look closely, can be seen the tiny ant-like figures of an army advancing to its doom. The machine gunners poured bullets unceasingly into the oncoming British troops, traversing back and forth across the lines of oncoming men. A private in the Cambridge Battalion of the Suffolks in the 4th Army's 34th Division described the scene as the battalion attacked La Boiselle.
The long line of men came forward, rifles at the port, as ordered. Now Jerry started. His machine guns let fly and down they all went. I could see them drop in one after the other as a gun swept along them. The officer went down at exactly the same time as a man behind him. Another minute or so and the next wave came forward. Well, Jerry was ready this time, and this lot didn't get as far as the others. They were caught in a storm of bullets, and I saw men twirl round and fall in all kinds of curious ways as they were hit. Quite unlike the way they do it in films.
The Cambridge Battalion were to lose 527 officers and men during that first day of the battle. The men of the 3rd and 4th Armies were mercilessly slain as they attempted to cross no man's land. To add to their miseries, the German artillery switched its fire from the British reserve trenches and gun positions to the main attack, sending accurate shell fire directly into their massed ranks. Those fortunate enough to escape the bullets and shells and actually arrive at the German wire faced the next unforeseen problem. The wire, supposed to have been cut to shreds, was in most places completely untouched. And even where it had been displaced, the wire had sprang back into huge coils, presenting an impregnable barrier to progress. The men fought hard to cross, but they inevitably became caught on the barbs, presenting the Germans with more unmissable targets. The wire soon became littered with the bodies of those enmeshed and machine-gunned as they tried to struggle free. During the first hours of the Battle of the Somme, there were many acts of individual and collective heroism, with the men of so many units displaying a selfless courage and dogged determination which ended in tragic loss of life. The story of the four battalions of the Tyneside Irish perhaps sums up this incredible but futile bravery. The attack on La Boiselle was made by the 34th Division under Major General Ingoville Williams, a popular commander known to the men as Inky Bill. La Boiselle was at the heart of the main attack, and its capture was vital to British success, as it lay on the main road to Bapaume and the German second and third lines. Ingoville Williams had planned that two brigades of the 34th Division would storm the front line trenches. Behind the main British front line were placed the four battalions of the Tyneside Irish in what was called the Tara Ushna line. This line was approximately 1 mile behind the main British front line trench. The two positions were separated by the wide open spaces of Avoca Valley. The Tynesides were ordered to make a simultaneous assault and to sweep through the gap created by the Tyneside Scottish and other battalions to their front. The collapse in German resistance would be exploited by the cavalry under Lieutenant General Sir Hubert Gough, which lay in reserve. But as we have seen, the deeply entrenched German machine gunners had not been destroyed by the artillery bombardment. As they raced to their positions, they were confronted with the Tyneside Irish Brigade with its 3,000 men walking down the completely open, exposed slopes of the Tara and Ushna Hills. The German gunners could hardly miss their targets and were soon unleashing a constant stream of murderous fire into the ranks. Wave followed wave, and the Tynesiders were cruelly slaughtered as they continued their advance, still nearly 1 mile away from their own front line. The two battalions on the left flank of the attack, the 2nd and 3rd Tyneside Irish, were almost completely destroyed, with very few from its ranks ever reaching the British main line. However, the 1st and 4th battalions, moving over less exposed terrain, continued their move forward until their battered survivors reached the British frontline trenches. They had seen their number pitifully reduced and their comrades killed in their hundreds, but they did not stop or take refuge from the fire. They pressed on towards their objective as ordered, losing more men with each step of the way. Of the 3,000 who began the attack, fewer than 50 men made it across no man's land to the German lines, where they met up with what remained of the leading assault brigades. Although they were isolated deep inside enemy territory, they could clearly see the village of Contalmaison in the distance. Displaying astonishing bravery, they decided to attack the heavily defended position, and hopelessly outnumbered, they were cut down to a man. All that had been gained from their futile attack was the dubious distinction of having advanced further than any other unit on the battlefront. The bitter and bloody fighting continued throughout the morning of July the 1st, and by midday, the extreme right wing of Rawlinson's 4th Army, the 30th, 18th, Eastern and 7th Divisions had achieved nearly all their objectives, with the 30th in particular gaining great success at Montauban. It was the only division on the battlefront to complete its tasks for the morning. The remainder of the 4th Army front line presented a picture of almost unremitting failure, save for the 36th Ulster Division, which had advanced, albeit with many casualties, beyond the German front line into the Schwaben Redoubt. But even here, their hold on the position was tenuous. In all other sectors of the 4th Army front line, attacks had been repulsed. At Gommecourt, the site of the diversionary attack, the Third Army met with the same terrible fate as the Fourth Army to the south, with Allenby's misgivings about the attack proving tragically correct. The 46th North Midlands Division in particular, to the extreme north, were given a horrible mauling.
I was shell-shocked, I suppose. At any rate, I wasn't much use. Inclined to cry, if anything. In fact, I couldn't stop it. But it had been a total shambles. The first two companies got across. I was told to take B Company across to support them. We had no idea that the whole attack was a diversion. We thought we were going forward. We had maps and plans of Gomcourt. We knew from information we'd got from local people exactly where every house was. But the trouble was that Gomcourt stuck out in the middle of the line and we didn't attack it directly. We attacked one side of the Chateau Park and the 56th Division attacked on the other. We were supposed to encircle it and link up behind. But what we didn't know was that the Germans had so manoeuvred and organised their line that this part which we weren't to attack was really their strong point. And they simply had a clear field of fire on either side and nothing to bother about in front. And the shell fire was absolutely appalling. They were simply pouring shells down. We just couldn't get across. We didn't even get as far as the trench we'd dug. Well, there was no trench left. It was all hammered to blazes. We got just about as far as our old front line. And then it became quite impossible. The company in front of me said, "It's no use, we can't get over." We got orders to turn and try to make our way back to the village. One of my subalterns was newly out, such a nice chap. He must have had money and we used to tease him a bit because his Batman was the family butler. Anyway, this young officer jumped out of the trench to try and organise the men, pass the word and get them moving to the communication trench. And he was promptly killed. Just disappeared in an explosion. The whole of the valley was being swept with machine gun fire and hammered with shells. We got the men organised the best we could, those of us who were left. So many gone, and we'd never even got past our own frontline trench. And then we found we couldn't get back. The trenches were indescribable. We were simply treading on the dead. Eventually, my sergeant and I got out on top. We were at the back of the company. I heard a shell coming. I remember thinking, imagine. Just imagine hearing a single shell in the middle of all this din. It burst above my head. The sergeant was blown one way and I was blown the other. He was killed. I don't know how I got back. I simply don't know how I got back. It was murder.
To the south of Gomcourt, the 56th London Division had, in the face of fierce resistance, captured the German frontline trench. And it was the few successes such as these which gave the cameras their opportunity to record the first sightings of German prisoners. However, despite the Londoners' success, the 46th North Midlanders to the north had been virtually wiped out, so the planned link-up between the two became impossible, rendering the costly efforts of the 56th Division all but useless. It is difficult to accurately assess what the mauling had cost in British lives, but it is estimated that over 50,000 soldiers had been killed or wounded, this in just 4.5 hours of fighting. Little had been gained for these enormous losses. Despite the almost superhuman courage and determination displayed by British soldiers along the entire front, all they had to show were a few yards of shell-ravaged ground and a pathetic trail of shaken prisoners. In no man's land lay over half an army, thousands dead, many more wounded, some unhurt but sheltering in shallows and shell holes. To these poor souls, the day that had dawned so full of hope for a decisive big push had turned into a blood-soaked, terrifying nightmare. And so, as noon came and went, the German defenders could survey the battlefield in satisfaction, for the big British attack had been broken and repulsed in all except three sectors. Huge casualties had been inflicted on the enemy, and counterattacks were being planned or made in all areas where ground had been lost.
The great majority of the 60,000 casualties of 1st of July 1916 happened in the first 30 minutes of the day. It was hellish, the only word for it. Not only was all the German artillery zeroed down exactly to no man's land, as one might have expected, but all machine guns were also firing on fixed lines from the German positions. And in many cases, troops did not even get out of their trenches. There's a famous example of one battalion which lost two-thirds of its strength before it got to the front line in the support trenches coming up as the second wave. So men were falling in literally hundreds in all directions. And yet, of course, they went on. At the walk, remember, not taking any form of cover. The military dictator of the day said that any soldier who took cover would not come out of cover again. He'd go to ground and stay there. And everywhere, the Germans having really a most marvellous target.
The afternoon offensive opened with the British desperate to salvage something from the morning's disasters. But still, renewed attacks were ordered against a well-prepared and confident enemy. At Fricourt, on the right flank of the 4th Army, the 7th East Yorks had relieved the 10th West Yorks, who had lost 710 men in the morning's action. At 2:30, they rose from their trench just as their comrades had done only 7 hours earlier and moved towards the enemy. A single German machine gun raked their lines. And before they had travelled 20 yards, the order came to return to the trenches. The three-minute assault had left 123 men dead or wounded. On the extreme left flank of the 3rd Army, the shattered remnants of the 46th North Midland Division were ordered to attack again and link up with the London Division behind Gommecourt. Commanders and soldiers alike could clearly see the hopelessness of their position. But the realities were not so apparent to Corps HQ behind the lines. Major General Stuart Wortley, the divisional commander, was horrified by the order and forcibly expressed his extreme misgivings. As a result of his protests, the attack was twice postponed. But eventually, and reluctantly, Stuart Wortley agreed to commit two companies to the assault. However, further disaster and misfortune awaited them, as a company commander recalls.
I was promised an artillery barrage and a smoke screen. I pointed out that most of the mortars that fired the smoke bombs were out of action, but I was told the attack must go on. The trenches were so muddy and overcrowded with wounded men that I had great difficulty in deploying my four platoons. But eventually, they were ready. My own CO came up 10 minutes before the attack was due to start. He watched the smoke screen and the bombardment, which were quite inadequate.
The one area of cheer for British High Command during the afternoon came at Mametz, between Fricourt and Montauban, where spirited fighting by the 7th Division, supported by accurate artillery fire, had resulted in the capture of the village. This footage shows Mametz on July the 5th, 4 days after its capture. But Mametz was an isolated success, and little could be done to exploit it. As the day ended, it was obvious that the British big push had been a confused, bloody, costly disaster.
That night, the captain begged me to shoot him, as he was so badly hurt. But I couldn't. I went back the next morning, and he died during the night. Some time later, when I got back to the trenches, an officer's servant stopped me coming in. His lieutenant was dying, and the soldier was straining to catch his last words. I heard the officer giving his instructions that a watch to be sent back to his family. Then he died, and I was allowed to come back in.
The afternoon story was in many ways a repetition, on perhaps a slightly slower scale, of the disasters of the morning. Apart from the capture of the famous Mametz Redoubt, which was probably the most important position which we did achieve on the first day of the Somme, the casualties were now mounting horrendously. So the battle raged on. By the end, of course, we have that terrible total, which is normally simplified down as 60,000 casualties, 20,000 of them dead.
Contemporary newsreels naturally overemphasized the small batches of German prisoners and did their best to exaggerate their size and significance. Compared to the anticipated deluge of prisoners, these tiny clutches of beaten men were a further disappointment to the high command. 50% of the men who had attacked the German trenches on July 1, 1916, had been killed or wounded. Officers suffered an even higher casualty rate, over 75% killed or wounded. The small batches of prisoners were used to conceal the numbing truth that there had been two British casualties for every yard of the 18-mile front from Gommecourt in the north to Montauban in the south. Losses on that first day alone had exceeded those recorded in the Crimean War, Boer War, and Korean War combined. As the High Command took stock of the situation on the evening of July the 1st, they must have been bitterly disappointed by their meagre achievements. There was some small success on the right flank, but abject and total failure in the centre and on the left. They must also have reflected for the first time on the catalogue of errors and misjudgments that had cost so many lives. That the battle was fought in a sector where the Germans had such a great tactical advantage. Indeed, the few soldiers who had fought their way into enemy positions had been mortified to look back and see clearly into their own trenches overlooked by the German positions. And of course, no one had realized or suspected how deep the enemy dugouts were. 30 or 40 feet deep, some of them so well organized they enjoyed electric light. Some were even wallpapered. The Battle of the Somme was to rage on for another 4 months, sucking in more men and precious resources. By the second day, even Sir Douglas Haig had seen and heard enough to observe that the news was not altogether good.
The Somme had one big strategic advantage, of that there is no doubt. The French found themselves with the Germans pulling back from Verdun, so that great offensive came to a full stop. The effect on the British public at large was to rally them behind the war, to fight it with even more determination than ever. Both sides, however, suffered very gravely. We lost perhaps the flower of the British youth, many of them, but not all, officers, of course. The Germans lost, equally importantly, almost the whole of their trained and experienced non-commissioned officers. And we could still learn. General Rawlinson, although he took much of the flak, if we can use that later phrase, for the effects of the battle and the 420,000 casualties we had sustained by the time the battle was closed down, yet he was able to learn from his errors. And it would be the same General Rawlinson who in 1918 would take the lead in a great attack in the Battle of Amiens, when things went far better, because the lessons of the Somme, and above all of its early stages, had been absorbed. One other very important thing, of course, which came out of the Somme was the first use of the tank. Had it been used, it would be at Cambrai next year, 300 tanks in action there. Well, who can tell whether, in fact, Haig would have achieved his breakthrough victory after all. In later years, he said he didn't want a breakthrough victory. He'd only intended an attritional battle in order to help Verdun. Well, that certainly wasn't the way that he briefed his generals and officers for it before it began. He was going for victory, of that there's no doubt at all.
As a human experience of unimaginable horror, the memory of the Somme is everlasting. And the haunting echoes of the battle linger forever in the plaintive voices of those who were there.
My revulsion at the ghastly horrors of war was submerged in the belief that this war was the war to end all wars and utopia would arise. What an illusion!
I made up my mind that if I ever got out of it alive, there wasn't enough gold in the Bank of England to get me back again.
My strongest recollection was of all of those grand-looking cavalrymen ready mounted to follow the breakthrough. What a hope.
5 minutes after the attack had started, the British public could have seen the wounded struggling to get out of line. The war would have been stopped by public opinion.
It was pure, bloody murder. Douglas Haig should have been hung, drawn and quartered for what he did on the Somme. Ingoville Williams had planned that two brigades of the 34th Division would storm the frontline trenches. Behind the main British front line were placed the four battalions of the Tyneside Irish in what was called the Tara Ushna Line. This line was approximately 1 mile behind the main British front line trench. The two positions were separated by the wide open spaces of Avoca Valley. The Tynesides were ordered to make a simultaneous assault and to sweep through the gap created by the Tyneside Scottish and other battalions to their front. The collapse in German resistance would be exploited by the cavalry under Lieutenant General Sir Hubert Gough, which lay in reserve. But as we have seen, the deeply entrenched German machine gunners had not been destroyed by the artillery bombardment. As they raced to their positions, they were confronted with the Tyneside Irish Brigade with its 3,000 men walking down the completely open, exposed slopes of the Tara and Ushna Hills. The German gunners could hardly miss their targets and were soon unleashing a constant stream of murderous fire into the ranks. Wave followed wave, and the Tynesiders were cruelly slaughtered as they continued their advance, still nearly 1 mile away from their own front line. The two battalions on the left flank of the attack, the 2nd and 3rd Tyneside Irish, were almost completely destroyed, with very few from its ranks ever reaching the British main line. However, the 1st and 4th battalions, moving over less exposed terrain, continued their move forward until their battered survivors reached the British frontline trenches. They had seen their number pitifully reduced and their comrades killed in their hundreds. But they did not stop or take refuge from the fire. They pressed on towards their objective as ordered, losing more men with each step of the way. Of the 3,000 who began the attack, fewer than 50 men made it across no man's land to the German lines, where they met up with what remained of the leading assault brigades. Although they were isolated deep inside enemy territory, they could clearly see the village of Contalmaison in the distance. Displaying astonishing bravery, they decided to attack the heavily defended position, and hopelessly outnumbered, they were cut down to a man. All that had been gained from their futile attack was the dubious distinction of having advanced further than any other unit on the battlefront. The bitter and bloody fighting continued throughout the morning of July the 1st, fatal to British success, as it lay on the main road to Bapaume and the German 2nd and 3rd lines. Ingoville Williams had planned that two brigades of the 34th Division would storm the frontline trenches. Behind the main British front line were placed the four battalions of the Tyneside Irish in what was called the Tara Ushna Line. This line was approximately 1 mile behind the main British front line trench. The two positions were separated by the wide open spaces of Avoca Valley. The Tynesides were ordered to make a simultaneous assault and to sweep through the gap created by the Tyneside Scottish and other battalions to their front. The collapse in German resistance would be exploited by the cavalry under Lieutenant General Sir Hubert Gough, which lay in reserve. But as we have seen, the deeply entrenched German machine gunners had not been destroyed by the artillery bombardment. As they raced to their positions, they were confronted with the Tyneside Irish Brigade with its 3,000 men walking down the completely open, exposed slopes of the Tara and Ushna Hills. The German gunners could hardly miss their targets and were soon unleashing a constant stream of murderous fire into the ranks. Wave followed wave, and the Tynesiders were cruelly slaughtered as they continued their advance, still nearly 1 mile away from their own front line. The two battalions on the left flank of the attack, the 2nd and 3rd Tyneside Irish, were almost completely destroyed, with very few from its ranks ever reaching the British main line. However, the 1st and 4th battalions, moving over less exposed terrain, continued their move forward until their battered survivors reached the British frontline trenches. They had seen their number pitifully reduced and their comrades killed in their hundreds. But they did not stop or take refuge from the fire. They pressed on towards their objective as ordered, losing more men with each step of the way. Of the 3,000 who began the attack, fewer than 50 men made it across no man's land to the German lines, where they met up with what remained of the leading assault brigades. Although they were isolated deep inside enemy territory, they could clearly see the village of Contalmaison in the distance. Displaying astonishing bravery, they decided to attack the heavily defended position, and hopelessly outnumbered, they were cut down to a man. All that had been gained from their futile attack was the dubious distinction of having advanced further than any other unit.
They were given their battle inoculation training. In their turn, the volunteer armies would have something like 600,000 casualties before the end of the year. So yet again, we had to produce the fourth type of army, and this was the conscript army. For the very first time in British history, we began to compulsorily conscript manpower for the armed forces. And that began in the autumn of 1916, and they would be the people who fought through 1917 and above all in 1918.
The opening day of the Battle of the Somme was fought on the middle day of the middle year of World War I. By this time, a position of stalemate had been reached by the opposing sides, for along the whole front line from the North Sea to the Swiss frontier, little or no progress was being made as the men of all armies dug themselves deep into trenches to defend their positions. To understand the nature of trench warfare is to appreciate the full range of horrors endured by the soldiers of the Great War. The typical British trench, seen here in side view, was usually 7 or 8 feet deep and 6 to 7 feet wide. Thick walls of sandbags provided protection from shell fragments or bullets, and in the walls of the trench were dugouts where a man would sleep or shelter from the elements. British High Command actually discouraged the construction of comfortable living quarters, and these dugouts were often cramped and wet, and hardly conducive to affording the rest the soldiers so desperately needed. The British frontline trench was never built in a straight line. This diagram illustrates the system of fire bays and traverses, which were designed to protect the men against bursting shells and enfilading or machine gun fire. Running out towards the opposing lines was a sap, a precarious vantage point for nervous sentries to oversee or overhear activities in the enemy positions or the approach of an enemy raiding party. To the rear of the main firing line were the support and reserve trenches, which completed the frontline system. The area between the two armies, called No Man's Land, varied in size from half a mile to only a few yards, depending on the lie of the ground. The positions of both were defended by thick belts of barbed wire. A major problem for the frontline troops was the sheer tedium of trench life, the dullness and difficulty of which was enough to wear down the hardiest of souls. Days were spent in an attempt to rest, while nights involved patrols, or digging latrines, or repairing trenches, or carrying up rations and other supplies. For most, this uncomfortable, wearying routine was broken only sporadically by action. Sustaining the huge army on the Western Front presented even more problems. Whilst actively at the front, the men rarely, if ever, received a hot meal, their staple diet being bread, bully beef, and biscuits. Drinking water, too, was in short supply. In the worst recorded cases, men were desperate enough to boil water drawn from the bottom of a shell hole. The filth of the trenches inevitably produced a host of diseases, and the men's unwashed condition brought the problem of lice, which tormented most soldiers. But if these horrors were not enough, without doubt the most unpleasant problem encountered by the British soldier was the rat, which grew to incredible size, bloated by gorging on the many half-buried corpses which littered the area around the trenches. Men would be woken by rats scurrying over their faces as they searched for food in their dugouts. A French soldier told one horrifying story. One evening, whilst on patrol, Jacques saw some rats running from under the dead men's greatcoats. Enormous rats, fat with human flesh. His heart pounding, he edged towards one of the bodies. Its helmet had rolled off. The man displayed a grimacing face, stripped of flesh, the skull bare, the eyes devoured. The rats coexisted with the men in the trenches. All efforts to rid themselves of their unwanted neighbours ended in failure, and the rats swarmed around in their millions throughout the war. All of these things contributed to the miserable life of the British Tommy on the Western Front during the war. Not only was he in danger from rifle or machine gun fire or shelling from the enemy artillery or the bullets from snipers, but he had to live with the daily risk of disease, infection and illness. British statistics tell the awful tale. During the Great War, there were more than 2.5 million casualties in battle, whilst 3.5 million were victims of sickness or disease. As his chief weapon, the British infantryman carried the .303 Lee Enfield rifle, fairly accurate up to 1,000 yards, with its long bayonet for hand-to-hand combat. The infantry were also supported by heavy machine guns, which took 6 men to operate and carry its ammunition supply. But it was a murderous weapon when in full flow, firing some 600 rounds per minute. In this most static of wars, however, the combatants were, for the majority of time, hidden from each other's view.
We were simply treading on the dead. Eventually, my sergeant and I got out on top. We were at the back of the company. I heard a shell coming. I remember thinking, imagine. Just imagine hearing a single shell in the middle of all this din. It burst above my head. The sergeant was blown one way and I was blown the other. He was killed. I don't know how I got back. I simply don't know how I got back. It was murder.
To the south of Gommecourt, the 56th London Division had, in the face of fierce resistance, captured the German frontline trench. And it was the few successes such as these which gave the cameras their opportunity to record the first sightings of German prisoners. However, despite the Londoners' success, the 46th North Midlanders to the north had been virtually wiped out, so the planned link-up between the two became impossible, rendering the costly efforts of the 56th Division all but useless. It is difficult to accurately assess what the morning had cost in British lives, but it is estimated that over 50,000 soldiers had been killed or wounded, this in just 4.5 hours of fighting. Little had been gained for these enormous losses. Despite the almost superhuman courage and determination displayed by British soldiers along the entire front, all they had to show were a few yards of shell-ravaged ground and a pathetic trail of shaken prisoners. In no man's land lay over half an army, thousands dead, many more wounded, some unhurt but sheltering in shallows and shell holes. To these poor souls, the day that had dawned so full of hope for a decisive big push had turned into a blood-soaked, terrifying nightmare. And so, as noon came and went, the German defenders could survey the battlefield in satisfaction, for the big British attack had been broken and repulsed in all except 3 sectors. Huge casualties had been inflicted on the enemy, and counterattacks were being planned or made in all areas where ground had been lost.
The great majority of the 60,000 casualties of 1st of July 1916 happened in the first 30 minutes of the day. It was hellish, the only word for it. Not only was all the German artillery zeroed down exactly to no man's land, as one might have expected, but all machine guns were also firing on fixed lines from the German positions. And in many cases, troops did not even get out of their trenches. There's a famous example of one battalion which lost two-thirds of its strength before it got to the front line in the support trenches, coming up as a second wave.
Experience. And it was his plan that was finally adopted. A five-day artillery barrage, followed by a measured advance to occupy the devastated German positions. The plan agreed, the British prepared for July the 1st, and behind the front lines, whole divisions rehearsed for their part in the attack. Sappers dug tunnels under key points in the German trenches to lay several massive mines, which were to be detonated shortly before the main attack began. In addition, food and ammunition were moved to the front line in enormous quantities. General Headquarters had the unpleasant task of preparing for the expected number of casualties. But upon seeing their detailed plans, Rawlinson thought their provision inadequate.
With reference to the evacuation of the wounded from the 4th Army area, I consider it essential that means of evacuation by trains should be provided for at least 10,000 wounded per day, in order to avoid undue overcrowding and discomfort for the wounded in the casualty clearing stations and other medical units. In order to evacuate this number, 12 ambulance trains and 6 improvised ambulance trains will be required daily by the Army. It appears to be necessary that the number of trains available for the 4th Army should be considerably increased. If the delays, which I understand, occurred during the Loos fighting in September last, are to be avoided.
The plans and preparations were believed to have been the most meticulous ever made for an action by a British force. Surely, as Rawlinson envisaged, all the men had to do was wait for the massive guns to do their work, then move across no man's land and into the smashed enemy trenches, which would be full of dead Germans or dazed survivors waiting to be taken prisoner. Their officers were confident. "You'll be able to go over the top with a walking stick. You'll not need rifles. When you get to Thiepval, you'll find all the Germans dead. Not even a rat will have survived." The Brigadier General of the King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry was even more confident. "When you go over the top, you can slope arms, light up your pipes and cigarettes, and march all the way to Pozières before meeting any live Germans."
Haig, of course, was hoping for a breakthrough, a major breakthrough which would lead to the end of the war. So it was a 17-mile front from north to south, and that is not even including the French sector south of the River Somme, which we must remember there were two or three French corps involved in this battle, who in fact did rather well on their sector. The disaster was going to be earned pretty much on the British sector. A great deal of importance was laid upon the preliminary artillery bombardment. General Rawlinson clearly believed in the old adage that artillery...
"We got the men organized the best we could, those of us who were left. So many gone, and we'd never even got past our own frontline trench. And then we found we couldn't get back. The trenches were indescribable. We were simply treading on the dead. Eventually, my sergeant and I got out on top. We were at the back of the company. I heard a shell coming. I remember thinking, imagine. Just imagine hearing a single shell in the middle of all this din. It burst above my head. The sergeant was blown one way and I was blown the other. He was killed. I don't know how I got back. I simply don't know how I got back. It was murder."
To the south of Gommecourt, the 56th London Division had, in the face of fierce resistance, captured the German frontline trench. And it was the few successes such as these which gave the cameras their opportunity to record the first sightings of German prisoners. However, despite the Londoners' success, the 46th North Midlanders to the north had been virtually wiped out, so the planned link-up between the two became impossible, rendering the costly efforts of the 56th Division all but useless. It is difficult to accurately assess what the morning had cost in British lives. But it is estimated that over 50,000 soldiers had been killed or wounded. This in just 4.5 hours of fighting. Little had been gained for these enormous losses. Despite the almost superhuman courage and determination displayed by British soldiers along the entire front, all they had to show were a few yards of shell-ravaged ground and a pathetic trail of shaken prisoners. In no man's land lay over half an army, thousands dead, many more wounded, some unhurt but sheltering in shallows and shell holes. To these poor souls, the day that had dawned so full of hope for a decisive big push had turned into a blood-soaked, terrifying nightmare. And so, as noon came and went, the German defenders could survey the battlefield in satisfaction, for the big British attack had been broken and repulsed in all except three sectors. Huge casualties had been inflicted on the enemy, and counterattacks were being planned or made in all areas where ground had been lost.
The great majority of the 60,000 casualties of 1st of July 1916 happened in the first 30 minutes of the day. It was hellish, the only word for it. Not only was all the German artillery zeroed down exactly to no man's land, as one might have expected,
such as these, which gave the cameras their opportunity to record the first sightings of German prisoners. However, despite the Londoners' success, the 46th North Midlanders to the north had been virtually wiped out, so the planned link-up between the two became impossible, rendering the costly efforts of the 56th Division all but useless. It is difficult to accurately assess what the morning had cost in British lives, but it is estimated that over 50,000 soldiers had been killed or wounded, this in just 4.5 hours of fighting. Little had been gained for these enormous losses. Despite the almost superhuman courage and determination displayed by British soldiers along the entire front, all they had to show were a few yards of shell-ravaged ground and a pathetic trail of shaken prisoners. In no man's land lay over half an army, thousands dead, many more wounded, some unhurt but sheltering in shallows and shell holes. To these poor souls, the day that had dawned so full of hope for a decisive big push had turned into a blood-soaked, terrifying nightmare. And so, as noon came and went, the German defenders could survey the battlefield in satisfaction, for the big British attack had been broken and repulsed in all except three sectors. Huge casualties had been inflicted on the enemy, and counterattacks were being planned or made in all areas where ground had been lost.
The great majority of the 60,000 casualties of 1st of July 1916 happened in the first 30 minutes of the day. It was hellish, the only word for it. Not only was all the German artillery zeroed down exactly to no man's land, as one might have expected, but all machine guns were also firing on fixed lines from the German positions. And in many cases, troops did not even get out of their trenches. There's a famous example of one battalion which lost two-thirds of its strength before it got to the front line in the support trenches coming up as the second wave. So men were falling in literally hundreds in all directions. And yet, of course, they went on. At the walk, remember, not taking any form of cover. The military dictator of the day said that any soldier who took cover would not come out of cover again. He'd go to ground and stay there. And everywhere, the Germans having really a most marvellous target.
The afternoon offensive opened with the British desperate to salvage something from the morning's disasters. But still, renewed attacks were ordered against a well-prepared and confident enemy. At Fricourt, on the right flank of the 4th Army, the 7th East Yorks had relieved the 10th West Yorks, who had lost 710 men in the morning's action. And inadequate.
With reference to the evacuation of the wounded from the 4th Army area, I consider it essential that means of evacuation by trains should be provided for at least 10,000 wounded per day, in order to avoid undue overcrowding and discomfort for the wounded in the casualty clearing stations and other medical units. in order to evacuate this number, 12 ambulance trains and 6 improvised ambulance trains will be required daily by the Army. It appears to be necessary that the number of trains available for the 4th Army should be considerably increased. If the delays, which I understand, occurred during the Loos fighting in September last, are to be avoided.
The plans and preparations were believed to have been the most meticulous ever made for an action by a British force. Surely, as Rawlinson envisaged, all the men had to do was wait for the massive guns to do their work, then move across no man's land and into the smashed enemy trenches, which would be full of dead Germans or dazed survivors waiting to be taken prisoner. Their officers were confident. "You'll be able to go over the top with a walking stick. You'll not need rifles. When you get to Tiepval, you'll find all the Germans dead. Not even a rat will have survived." The Brigadier General of the King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry was even more confident. "When you go over the top, you can slope arms, light up your pipes and cigarettes, and march all the way to Pozières before meeting any live Germans."
Haig, of course, was hoping for a breakthrough, a major breakthrough which would lead to the end of the war. So it was a 17-mile front from north to south, and that is not even including the French sector south of the River Somme, which we must remember there were 2 or 3 French corps involved in this battle, who in fact did rather well on their sector. The disaster was going to be earned pretty much on the British sector. A great deal of importance was laid upon the preliminary artillery bombardment. General Rawlinson clearly believed in the old adage that artillery conquers, infantry occupies. And so they had this 5-day bombardment, which of course sacrificed any concept of surprise in preparation, on the promise that that would destroy many of the enemy's positions, above all the barbed wire, which in fact it didn't, that it would cause a tremendous amount of shell shock and battle shock amongst the enemy, which of course it didn't, because they were mostly in 40-foot deep dugouts. And, of course, the British were also going to fire these famous mines along the German front to really destroy parts of the sectors, which they didn't, because the Germans rushed out with their machine guns into the huge craters and found themselves with new made positions courtesy of the British Army. But then the orders were given to these battalions.
Batches of prisoners were used to conceal the numbing truth that there had been 2 British casualties for every yard of the 18-mile front from Gommecourt in the north to Montauban in the south. Losses on that first day alone had exceeded those recorded in the Crimean War, Boer War, and Korean War combined. As the High Command took stock of the situation on the evening of July the 1st, they must have been bitterly disappointed by their meagre achievements. There was some small success on the right flank, but abject and total failure in the centre and on the left. They must also have reflected for the first time on the catalogue of errors and misjudgments that had cost so many lives. That the battle was fought in a sector where the Germans had such a great tactical advantage. Indeed, the few soldiers who had fought their way into enemy positions had been mortified to look back and see clearly into their own trenches overlooked by the German positions. And of course, no one had realized or suspected how deep the enemy dugouts were. 30 or 40 feet deep. Some of them so well organized they enjoyed electric light. Some were even wallpapered. The Battle of the Somme was to rage on for another 4 months, sucking in more men and precious resources. By the second day, even Sir Douglas Haig had seen and heard enough to observe that the news was not altogether good.
The Somme had one big strategic advantage, of that there is no doubt. The French found themselves with the Germans pulling back from Verdun. So that great offensive came to a full stop. The effect on the British public at large was to rally them behind the war, to fight it with even more determination than ever. Both sides, however, suffered very gravely. We lost perhaps the flower of the British youth, many of them, but not all, officers, of course. The Germans lost, equally importantly, almost the whole of their trained and experienced non-commissioned officers. And we could still learn General Rawlinson, although he took much of the flak, if we can use that later phrase, for the effects of the battle and the 420,000 casualties we had sustained by the time the battle was closed down, yet he was able to learn from his errors. And it would be the same General Rawlinson who in 1918 would take the lead in a great attack in the Battle of Amiens, when things went far better, because the lessons of the Somme, and above all of its early stages, had been absorbed. One other very important thing, of course, that came out of the Somme was the first use of the tank. Had it been used, it would be at Cambrai next year, 300 tanks in action there. Well, who can tell whether, in fact, Haig would have achieved his breakthrough victory after.
By the second day, even Sir Douglas Haig had seen and heard enough to observe that the news was not altogether good.
The Somme had one big strategic advantage, of that there is no doubt. The French found themselves with the Germans pulling back from Verdun, so that great offensive came to a full stop. The effect on the British public at large was to rally them behind the war, to fight it with even more determination than ever. Both sides, however, suffered very gravely. We lost perhaps the flower of the British youth, many of them, but not all, officers, of course. The Germans lost, equally importantly, almost the whole of their trained and experienced non-commissioned officers. And we could still learn. General Rawlinson, although he took much of the flak, if we can use that later phrase, for the effects of the battle and the 420,000 casualties we had sustained by the time the battle was closed down, yet he was able to learn from his errors. And it would be the same General Rawlinson who in 1918 would take the lead in a great attack in the Battle of Amiens, when things went far better, because the lessons of the Somme, and above all of its early stages, had been absorbed. One other very important thing, of course, that came out of the Somme was the first use of the tank. Had it been used, it would be at Cambrai next year, 300 tanks in action there. Well, who can tell whether, in fact, Haig would have achieved his breakthrough victory after all. In later years, he said he didn't want a breakthrough victory. He'd only intended an attritional battle in order to help Verdun. Well, that certainly wasn't the way that he briefed his generals and officers for it before it began. He was going for victory, of that there's no doubt at all.
As a human experience of unimaginable horror, the memory of the Somme is everlasting. And the haunting echoes of the battle linger forever in the plaintive voices of those who were there.
My revulsion at the ghastly horrors of war was submerged in the belief that this war was the war to end all wars and utopia would arise. What an illusion!
I made up my mind that if I ever got out of it alive, there wasn't enough gold in the Bank of England to get me back again.
My strongest recollection was of all of those grand-looking cavalrymen ready mounted to follow the breakthrough. What a hope.
5 minutes after the attack had started, the British public could have seen the wounded struggling to get out of line. The war would have been stopped by public opinion.
It was pure bloody murder.
Well, Sir Hubert Gough, which lay in reserve. But as we have seen, the deeply entrenched German machine gunners had not been destroyed by the artillery bombardment. As they raced to their positions, they were confronted with the Tyneside Irish Brigade with its 3,000 men walking down the completely open, exposed slopes of the Tara and Ushna Hills. The German gunners could hardly miss their targets and were soon unleashing a constant stream of murderous fire into the ranks. Wave followed wave, and the Tynesiders were cruelly slaughtered as they continued their advance, still nearly 1 mile away from their own front line. The two battalions on the left flank of the attack, the 2nd and 3rd Tyneside Irish, were almost completely destroyed, with very few from its ranks ever reaching the British main line. However, the 1st and 4th battalions, moving over less exposed terrain, continued their move forward until their battered survivors reached the British frontline trenches. They had seen their number pitifully reduced and their comrades killed in their hundreds. But they did not stop, or take refuge from the fire. They pressed on towards their objective as ordered, losing more men with each step of the way. Of the 3,000 who began the attack, fewer than 50 men made it across no man's land to the German lines, where they met up with what remained of the leading assault brigades. Although they were isolated deep inside enemy territory, they could clearly see the village of Contalmaison in the distance. Displaying astonishing bravery, they decided to attack the heavily defended position, and hopelessly outnumbered, they were cut down to a man. All that had been gained from their futile attack was the dubious distinction of having advanced further than any other unit on the battlefront. The bitter and bloody fighting continued throughout the morning of July the 1st, and by midday, the extreme right wing of Rawlinson's 4th Army, the 30th, 18th, Eastern and 7th Divisions, had achieved nearly all their objectives, with the 30th in particular gaining great success at Montauban. It was the only division on the battlefront to complete its tasks for the morning. The remainder of the 4th Army front line presented a picture of almost unremitting failure, save for the 36th Ulster Division, which had advanced, albeit with many casualties, beyond the German front line into the Schwaben Redoubt. But even here, their hold on the position was for almost exclusively new volunteers. Kitchener's Army, named after the Minister for War, Lord Kitchener, whose vigorous recruitment campaign had attracted almost 500,000 ordinary men to the colours. These men of the new army were eager, bursting, full of patriotism, ready to do their duty for king and country. But they were also raw and inexperienced. For many, the war offered undreamed of possibilities of travel and excitement and prospect of glory. The menfolk of entire towns and villages had joined up, making up the famous PALS or Chums battalions, where the whole population of an area would serve together in the same unit. These were the men who would suffer so terribly during their first taste of battle. Before the battle, the war was still viewed as a magnificent interlude from the toil and hardship of everyday life. A war to be heroically fought and, of course, gloriously won. But whatever their background or rank, none could have prepared themselves for the nightmare of violence and slaughter that awaited them.
It's not always realised that the British sent four different types of armies to fight in Flanders between 1914 and 1918. The first, of course, was the old BEF, British Expeditionary Force, probably the most professional army we've ever sent abroad. They, of course, were mostly dead by the early months of 1915, something like 70% casualties by that time. So the next army that came out to France was the Territorial Force, as they then called the Territorial Army, which were all, again, peacetime soldiers who had done weekend soldiering and so forth, just as the TA does now. And they were very good in their turn, but by the end of 1915, I'm afraid they too had gone in large number. And so when we turn at last to Kitchener's army, we've come to the third, and probably the most dramatic of all the armies we sent to France and Flanders that particular war. Now, of course, they were volunteers. These were mostly people who had volunteered in 1914, wishing to get into the war before it was all over by Christmas, was the famous phrase at the time. They'd been having 2.5 years being trained and were at the peak of physical fitness, but of course had no experience of the reality of battle whatsoever, except that which you could get on exercises or battle schools or the notorious Bullring up by Calais, where they were given their battle inoculation training. In their turn, the volunteer armies would have something like 600,000 casualties before the end of the year. So yet again, we had to produce the fourth type of army, and this was the conscript army. For the very first time in British history, we began to compulsorily conscript manpower for the armed forces. And that began in the autumn of 1916, and they would be the people who fought through 1917 and above all in 1918.
That had dawned so full of hope for a decisive big push had turned into a blood-soaked, terrifying nightmare. And so, as noon came and went, the German defenders could survey the battlefield in satisfaction, for the big British attack had been broken and repulsed in all except three sectors. Huge casualties had been inflicted on the enemy, and counterattacks were being planned or made in all areas where ground had been lost.
The great majority of the 60,000 casualties of 1st of July 1916 happened in the first 30 minutes of the day. It was hellish, the only word for it. Not only was all the German artillery zeroed down exactly to no man's land, as one might have expected, but all machine guns were also firing on fixed lines from the German positions. And in many cases, troops did not even get out of their trenches. There's a famous example of one battalion which lost two-thirds of its strength before it got to the front line in the support trenches, coming up as the second wave. So men were falling in literally hundreds in all directions. And yet, of course, they went on. At the walk, remember, not taking any form of cover. The military dictator of the day said that any soldier who took cover would not come out of cover again. He'd go to ground and stay there. And everywhere, the Germans having really a most marvellous target.
The afternoon offensive opened with the British desperate to salvage something from the morning's disasters. But still, renewed attacks were ordered against a well-prepared and confident enemy. At Fricourt, on the right flank of the 4th Army, the 7th East Yorks had relieved the 10th West Yorks, who had lost 710 men in the morning's action. At 2:30, they rose from their trench just as their comrades had done only 7 hours earlier and moved towards the enemy. A single German machine gun raked their lines. And before they had travelled 20 yards, the order came to return to the trenches. The three-minute assault had left 123 men dead or wounded. On the extreme left flank of the 3rd Army, the shattered remnants of the 46th North Midland Division were ordered to attack again and link up with the London Division behind Gommecourt. Commanders and soldiers alike could clearly see the hopelessness of their position. But the realities were not so apparent to Corps HQ behind the lines. Major General Stuart Wortley, the divisional commander, was horrified by the order and forcibly expressed his extreme misgivings. As a result of his protests, the attack was twice postponed. But eventually, and reluctantly, Stuart Wortley agreed to commit two companies to the assault. However, further disaster and misfortune awaited them.